100 or plus 8?
Sort of 100.
Does it say record in here, George? Is it supposed to say record in the viewfinder?
Yeah, already see at the top.
Oh yeah, there it goes.
Okay, give me another reading for 100.
The thing about the Wilburys for me is if we'd have tried to plan that, or if anybody had tried to, you know, say, let's form this band and get these people in it, it would never happen. It's impossible. And the thing happened completely just by magic, just by circumstances. Maybe there was a full moon that night or something like that. And it was quite a magical little thing, really. I had dinner with Roy Orbison and Jeff. And I said to Jeff, look, tomorrow I'm just going to go in a studio and make up a tune, and do you want to come and help? He said, sure. Bob, we knew, had this little studio. I phoned Bob up. I mean, sometimes you can phone him and not get through for years, but he picked up first ring and he said, sure, come on over. My guitar was at Tom Petty's house, so Tom, Jeff picked me up. We went over to Bob's. I got the first line, just had been beat up, battered around, and then wham, they just kept coming with all these lines. And there was Bob saying, well, what's it called? What's it about? And I finally saw behind his door this big box with a sticker on it saying Handle With Care. I said, Handle With Care? He said, oh, yeah, good.
Reputations changeable, situations terrible.
I liked the song and the way it had turned out with all these people on it so much. So I just carried it around in my pocket for ages, thinking, well, what can I do with this thing? And the only thing to do I could think of was do another nine, make an album.
And I said, yeah, that sounds like a real good idea, because it had really been such magic doing the first track.
Bob had to go on the road end of May, so we just sort of said, okay, we'll meet on the 7th of May or something like that.
All in a day's work for a Wilbury.
And we had like 9 or 10 days that we knew we could get Bob for, and everybody else was relatively free. So we just said, well, let's do it. We'll just write a tune a day and do it that way. It was very exciting.
And every time we start thinking about it, it just be, wow, and Roy Orbison's in the band.
All we planned was which weeks that we were all available to get together. But apart from that, there was no other plan. I mean, we set up a room where we were going to be, and then we walked in and we started writing the tune.
We were in Dave Stewart's house, and it was a nice environment because you could kind of sit outside. It was warm, and the doors were always open.
Why don't we do one like that?
He had a little tiny studio, but it wasn't a studio, it was more like just a control room with a vocal booth, so we didn't have any space to play the guitars. So we set up in his kitchen. It wasn't soundproofed or anything, and we just put like 5 chairs around the kitchen and put the microphones up, and that's it. So all them guitar parts, you know, all them acoustic guitars were just in this kitchen.
We did it for music. That's what it was all about. There wasn't a lot of deciding of what to do. Not a lot of time spent planning out anything. So we just wrote the best songs that we could write and sang them as best we could.
There at the bar when I got out of the car.
Oh, no, she was long and tall. She was
short and fat. She was dressed to kill.
Yeah, that's good.
She was to give me a thrill.
She was over the hill.
She was over the hill.
What's that?
She was dressed to kill. She was over the hill.
Just sitting around in a circle, like 5 of us just strumming acoustic guitars and coming up with a song in like a couple of hours that was almost ready to record, you know, and then recording it like on the evening. It's pretty sort of unbelievable stuff.
I looked at her eyes, they
They were full of surprise.
Sometimes we'd sing the same song, you know, just to see who sounded good or if this key fits somebody. And that was a lot of the fun of it.
And George would kind of audition us, which could be really intimidating, you know, because, like, you know, Roy Orbison had sing the song and then they'd send you out to sing it, you know, and it's like, well, damn, that's really intimidating.
And the Monkey Man was like really Tom Petty and Bob. Well, Jeff and I were there too, but we just sit around in the kitchen and he, for some reason, was talking about all this stuff which didn't make much sense to me. You know, it was that Americana kind of stuff. And we got a tape cassette and put it on and then transcribed everything they were saying. It was just fantastic watching him do it because he had like one take warming himself up. And on take two, he sang that Tweet and the Monkey Man right through. And then what he did was he changed some of the lyrics. Maybe in about four places, he changed a couple of lines and improved them and dropped those lines in. And that's it.
Let's get them near the souvenirs, Dan.
Yeah. An ambulance come rolling in, a state trooper close behind. Tweeter took his gun and tied him up and treated him unkind.
Huh?
Good?
Yeah.
I think it was good.
Okay.
The way he writes the words down, like very tiny, like a spider's written it, you know, you can't hardly read it. And that's the amazing thing. It's just unbelievable seeing how he did it. I mean, that for me was just amazing watching it because I had very little to do with writing that tune at all, except Jeff and I remembered a bit he did that he'd forgotten, which became that chorus.
Was that it? Jim started playing the shelves and it sounded great, you know, it sounded just like old Springs, but it sounded really good. It suited the track really well. Nothing was off limits, you know, you could record where you like, so it was opportunity to get sounds that you would never have got before.
Sound of it, I think, is just so close to a good old rock and roll thing from like the late 50s. But that partially is, I think, the guitars, the acoustics. And the fridge. I tell you, it's the great new sound, folks. What's happening? You know, it had to be a bit rough, but that was the fun about it. It's like the most basic rock and roll sound.
As you were doing it, you already felt like you were listening to the finished product and it sounded great. Those were very happy moments. To be listening to a song knowing that you've got it already and all you could do is make it better.
I love that track. It's just so funny, really. I mean, I don't know how other people write songs, but that bit, I just picked up a bunch of magazines and gave everybody a magazine. And I had some copies of Autosport. And they all just started reading out little things like five-speed gearbox and stuff like that. I had a camera up on that take when we were singing that. It's just a static shot through the window of us around the vocal mic.
How do we do it? We just go around?
I don't know.
Well, should we have a practice or something?
Yeah, let's practice it once.
Is that we singing it or just saying it or what?
I think we're singing it.
We just wrote this random list and had it on the microphone. And then we just did the take.
Every time it came round to Roy Orbison, he always got the Traveling Wilburys. And it was just the funniest thing. Roy, the big voice, the big operatic, Traveling Wilburys. And we all just collapsed every time. And no matter how we rearranged it, he always ended up with Traveling Wilburys on the end there.
How are you today?
Oh, I'm not so bad today, thanks, Tommy.
Yeah.
Not too bad. Dude.
Not too bad. How about you, Roy?
Wretch t-shirt on.
Hey, Roy, that thing the other day we filmed when we were doing the Wilbury bit, I saw it back the other night. You were just in stitches.
You got the line, I love your trembling Wilbury.
Yeah.
You love through your trembling.
And on another line, too.
I love your trembling. Not even travelling. Trembling. Whichever way I went around, it was a conspiracy or something, but if we started to the left, I got the duff lines. If we started to the right, I got the duff lines.
Why that? It was just meant to be, I think.
There was just a lot of music in the air and a lot of fun going around, a lot of parties, a lot of ukuleles till dawn. It wouldn't be unusual for Jeff and George to show up at my door with a case of beer and play ukuleles till dawn, with the children dropping like flies around us. And they'd just be tucked in a chair, and it'd be, Dad, I want to go home. No, just go to sleep, son. We're playing ukuleles now. You know, what Jeff brings most to a session is his enthusiasm and spark. Some producers don't like to be there and treat it as work, and it's more like, ooh, Dad's here, you know, so that kind of stuff. With Jeff, it was more like, oh, great, well, let's try this.
You know, officially, George and me are the producers. Yeah. But, you know, we all have lots of ideas for it. And at the end of the day, it's like, it is like a bunch of really fresh stuff, because when you're working on it, it's only like hours old, you know, it's not like you've had it there for months. You just do it, and it's really quick. The whole thing took 6 weeks from the first chord that we thought of to the finished mix of the last song. It was just a thrill, really, to write a song with Roy Orbison. It was an ambition that I'd always had, and it came true, which was great.
If you're just sitting on the sofa working on a song and Roy's singing, even when he sang soft, it's such a tone, such a sound, you know, such a gift, really. We used to always tell him, Roy, you must be the best singer in the world. And he'd say, yeah.
He has got, like, the best voice ever in pop music. So you can't get in the way of him either, you know, so it's a real tricky one. His voice is really big anyway, but obviously you don't want a weedy little backing, but it's really hard to make him fit in with his great big voice and still have some warmth behind it.
Thank you.
One night I broke in into the studio to try this alternative chord pattern, because that was one particular one I just couldn't come to terms with the way it was. And I just did it as an alternative. I put this Telecaster on, playing these other chords, and pulled out all the other stuff. And everybody else arrived and heard it as this new thing with, like, the same tune, but different chords. And they all loved it.
I put all I had into the project, but it's the other guys had visions of what I should sound like or what I should sing and things like that. So we didn't question each other, we just went right ahead.
I tell you, I love to hear all these guys sing so much that it was just for me. I could have just sat there and listened, really.
I think the tune on that one was, you know, we worked out the tune straight off, you know, together. But Bob basically had the idea for that. Congratulations.
Congratulations for breaking my heart. Congratulations for tearing it all apart.
The difference was the rest of us had more time, but Bob had to go on the road, and we knew he couldn't come over and do any more vocals again, so we had to get his vocals immediately.
Believing me in need. This morning I looked at my window and found a bluebird singing, but there was no one around. And
one of the most amazing things ever about the Wilburys was this poles apart thing of Roy and Bob Dylan. That's what I thought was wonderful, the best singer and the best lyricist, and both in the same group.
Congratulations, you got a good deal. Congratulations, how good you must feel.
I think my least favorite thing was having to go on tour while the album was, you know, getting started. I couldn't wait to get back.
I was really looking forward to getting down and making them into records, you know, all these tracks, what we could do on different songs. And we were so into it. George was so keen on the Wilburys, and so was I. I loved every minute of it. It was just beyond your wildest dreams. We had ideas from talking about it on the plane as we were flying over from LA to London, and took them back to England to George's studio. And to me, that's the most fun part. You just sort of throw them all up in the air and see which one you want to start with. But he's knocking them out of, you know, out of these rough loads of guitars all banging away and making a nice piece out of it.
It's a bit jazzy. Do you want to listen to it?
Yes, well, let's record on that.
Yeah, it was brilliant, the first part. Brilliant.
Hi Tom, welcome to
I think, well, George actually came up with the idea for it, like the main chord sequence, and we all contributed words to it. But George came up with the initial idea of it. And we tried to do something different and have like a nice film of just playing, you know, playing and all nice shots of guitars and heads and feet and stuff.
You can sit around and wait for the phone to ring. Waiting for someone to tell you everything.
sit around and wonder what tomorrow will bring. Maybe a diamond ring.
It worked. It's a really nice video. I'm really pleased with it because it's got a lot of quality photography.
Well, you never got bored on one of those shoots because we'd hang out in dressing rooms or in a Winnebago or a trailer or whatever. And a lot of times the guitars would come out and be singing and laughing and jokes. You know, a shoot can be pretty long sometimes. Those video shoots can be 12, 15 hours. And I don't remember ever getting tired or bored. And with a ringleader like George, you're never really going to stop. And I think that's probably what elated George the most, was that his idea was working. It's not only all the fun he wanted to have, it was coming out really good.
Roy went out on top, and I'm sure he knew that. The last conversation I had with him, it was a couple of days before he died on the phone, and he was just so thrilled that the Wilburys had gone platinum, and he was just, isn't it great? It's great. We all felt that Roy was a real special part of the group, and it was just our ace in the hole to have that voice come in. And he was so nice, you know, and it was so painful when he died.
Roy would have liked us to have continued to do The End of the Line. You know, it's a very optimistic song, and I mean, we love Roy. Life flows on within you and without you, and he's around, you know, in his astral body. He'll be cool.
Well, it's all right, even when push comes to shove. Well, it's all right, if you got someone to love. Well, it's all right, everything will work out fine. Well, it's all right, we're going to the end of the line.
The whole experience was just some of the best days of my life, really.
She wrote a long letter,
and I think it probably was for us all.
One short piece of paper.
The thing I guess would be hardest for people to understand is what good friends we were. It really had very little to do with combining a bunch of famous people. It was a bunch of friends that just happened to be really good at making music.
Being beat up and battered around, being sent up and I've been shut down. You're the best thing that I've ever found. Handle me with care.
None of this would have happened without him. It was George's band. It was always George's band. And it was a dream he'd had for a long time.
From my point of view, I just tried to preserve our relationship. I worked so hard to make sure that, you know, all the guys who were in that band and consequently on record and film, their friendship wasn't abused. Just to preserve our friendship, that was the underlying contribution, I think, what I was trying to do.
It was wonderful to see all these professionals just do their thing, you know. And it was a learning experience for me. So the doing of the album, that was my greatest time.
I was looking at it from, like, out of the Wilburys. I was looking at it like, wow, look at all these people together. This would be great.